Russian Revolution on Discovery Journal. Konstantin Chernenko had won. The old guard had chosen a general secretary they thought they could control. But at his first Politburo meeting as leader, Chernenko took them by surprise.
We were all standing in the Walnut Room outside the Politburo meeting room. That's where the Politburo members compare notes at the end of their sessions. The door opened and Ustinov and Tikhonov came out together. Ustinov put his hand on Tikhonov's shoulder, and I heard him say, "Kostya, that's Chernenko, will be more manageable than Misha, Gorbachev."
I think almost immediately Chernenko said, "Perhaps in my absence, when I'm on vacation or when I'm ill, I think Gorbachev will have to chair the meetings at the Politburo."
This offer of the deputy leadership would put Gorbachev back in line for the top job. The other members of the old guard wondered what was going on behind their backs.
Then Nikolai Tikhonov said, "Why Gorbachev? He's secretary for agriculture. Why should he be second secretary?" Other Politburo members piped up and said, "Why shouldn't he be?" But then the others replied, "Just because he's already in charge of the secretariat, does that mean he should chair the Politburo too?" So there was a real tug of war going on.
Tikhonov argued that Lenin would have done things differently.
Tikhonov said that he was absolutely against it. It would cause deviations, disorder in the country. But for some unknown reason, Chernenko decided for once that he would stand his ground. He said, "Well, you think your way, and I think mine."
There was a deadlock. But finally, a clever way out was found by our foreign minister, Andrei Gromyko. At that time, he took the floor and said something like this: "Comrades, both proposals have their pros, and both proposals have their cons. But Gorbachev has experience in chairing the secretariat. And so, let's let him continue with that, and we'll see how things go."
With Gromyko's help, Gorbachev effectively became second secretary. But even from this position, his power to make the party do anything about the dire state of the economy was limited, with Brezhnev's friends once again in charge. Soviet newsreels of the time showed a typically optimistic picture. The reality of the economic situation seemed to be visible only to the small group of reformers, reluctantly inherited by the new regime.
We couldn't detect any interest from General Secretary Chernenko, which put me in a bad mood. I really felt I wasn't needed. I went a few times to see Gorbachev, and I said, "Our work isn't needed. I feel like an outsider." Gorbachev would try to calm me down. He would say, "Don't get upset. One day, life itself will call for radical changes in our country."
Chernenko looked from the beginning like an interim leader. His health was poor. His term of office rapidly became a battleground for the future succession. Of course, there was no such thing as open campaigning. Gorbachev kept Ryzhkov and the rest of his team behind him and took what measures he could to weaken his Politburo rivals. For example,